I just wanted to say that the reality, of course, especially for foreign journalists, is that war is sexy and it's good and it gives them kudos and they all like to go and report on war. But of course, the bombs and the air raids don't fall on Hammersmith or on Acton, they fall on foreign countries. And so they go, they report, they get their sort of brownie points, and they return to the comfort of home. And the bombing and the destruction happens elsewhere, and those who are victims are the people from elsewhere. So I would seriously urge everyone, every time you're hearing the war drums, I think you should all question what is being said. You should all look into who is saying what. You should look at the, try and find out the background of those who are selling you the war and what interests they have, because more often than not, the way they have access to platforms, to media platforms, is really to say what the establishment wants them to say. They're not saying anything in the interest of their country. They're craving some sort of pat on the back to sell you a war that really, and war is never a good option. It really never is, and especially when the bombs are falling on your head. So I just wanted to sort of touch base on that because that is a classic. And our next speaker obviously was at the heart, really, when you say at the heart of events, it's really an understatement. He was the last spokesman for the Libyan Jamahiriya. He is now the part of the Executive National Popular Movement. It's of course Moussa Ibrahim, who is speaking to you all from Berlin. So please give a warm welcome to Moussa Ibrahim. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Peace be upon you all. I would like to thank the honorable members of the audience, our dear friends at the Tricontinental Platform, all honorable guests speaking at or attending this important event. Could I please just ask the organizers of this event to whom I'm speaking now? Is the audience composed of mainly Libyan political activists? Do we have non-Libyans attending? So I need to kind of take that into account when I speak about Libyan cities and Libyan geography and the like.
Yes, it's half. There are quite a few non-Libyans in the room. So please speak as if you're not talking to Libyans.
Fantastic. Of course, I wholeheartedly welcome all of you, and I actually thank you all for having me tonight. It's an honor. I speak to you today in the name of the Libyan National Popular Movement and with coordination with the Libyan High Council, High Social Council of Tribes and Cities. This is, in fact, a political and moral appeal to each and every one of you in regards to the terrible situation in my homeland of Libya. I address your hearts and minds as I represent more than 622 Libyan political leaders who come from the vast majority of the Libyan opposition inside and outside Libya. We hope as a movement to tackle the terrible nationwide consequences of NATO's war against the Libyan nation in 2011 and the following war and civil war taking place in the country. Our dialogue of the Libyan political leaders and cooperation for the last few years resulted in the establishment of one political body and one social body who are cooperating to represent part of the green resistance. We do not claim, of course, that we represent all the green resistance, but a good part of it. The Libyan Popular National Movement, in particular, is a peaceful political human rights movement that concentrates its activities around human rights issues, national dialogue, truth and reconciliation, initiatives for peace building, democracy and development. Of course, there is no secret where we come from. We are Green Libyans. We supported Brother Leader Muammar Gaddafi. We believed in the cause we're fighting for. But we are not strapped to the past. We do not belong to only a small part of Libya. We belong to all of Libya, even to those who differ with us politically, as long as they are not NATO supporters, as long as they are for the unity of Libya, for democracy in Libya, for peace building in Libya. In fact, at the moment, we believe there is no other organized, radical, peaceful Libyan opposition concerned with saving the country's future from the NATO-imposed puppet regime of criminal gangs, religious extremism, and tribal militias. We have a clear, well-analyzed, collectively discussed, and well-laid-out peaceful initiative to regain our country from the ugly jaws of religious fundamentalism, tribalism, organized crime, human rights violations, corruption, torture, assassinations, robbing and squandering of national wealth, political marginalizations of millions of Libyans, implementation of pseudo-political change under the intimidation of terror of armed fundamentalist groups. We seek your moral political support, whether you are Libyan or non-Libyan, as respected political activists, to get our voice through and our message through to the world. Yes, indeed, I was at the heart of the Libyan-NATO war in 2011, and I wasn't the only one. I was one of hundreds of thousands of Libyan youth who were involved in this conflict, most of whom sided with the nation, with the country of Libya, against NATO, against foreign intervention, against fundamentalist groups. I had the task to speak to the media and to organize the media and cultural work. I did my best, and I failed sometimes, I succeeded sometimes, but my respect and my thoughts go for the real heroes of this war. I'm not a real hero. The real heroes are the ones who took up their Kalashnikovs with little training. They fought the rockets. They fought against NATO's ships, NATO's airplanes, NATO's satellites, communications, and NATO's gangs in Libya. Those who lost their lives in the tens of thousands, those who are still suffering in the illegal dark prisons of Al-Qaeda organizations in Libya, those who are exiled in the millions outside of Libya, those are the real heroes and the real victims at the same time. As you all know, the suffering of the Libyan people started at the hands of foreign intervention, which was based on five lies or fabrications that were included, shockingly enough, in the United Nations Security Council resolutions 1970 and 1973 in 2011. I will try to be short, because I realize I could speak for a long time, so I will try to kind of shorten my speak. The lies, as you all know, were basically, one, the massacre of protesters. Second, the bombardments of cities and Tripoli neighborhoods. Third, the rape of thousands of women, systematic rape of thousands of women by the Libyan army. Fourth, the employment of around 30,000 mercenaries from Africa. And five, the potential Benghazi massacre that was claimed that was going to happen by the Libyan army entering the city. After almost 4 years now, everyone, even our enemies, understand and admit that all of these were lies and fabrications, and proven to be lies and fabrications. They declared in the UN, they actually wrote down this number. They said 10,000 protesters were killed in the first 4 days of events, from the 15th to the 19th of February. Now, the Transitional Council that was put in power by NATO after the collapse of Al-Jamahiriya admitted that 8 protesters, I would like to say this again, Mr. Mustafa Abdul Jalil himself admitted that 8 protesters were killed before NATO's intervention, not 10,000. Mr. Abdul Jalil, who is the head of the Transitional Council, the highest political position ever for those involved with NATO, said, and this is on a video interview available on the internet, that he had a meeting with Brother Leader Gaddafi and other heads of the important political and security organizations in Libya, in which the orders were very clear not to kill any protesters, not to face protesters with any power, to deal with the situation in Benghazi, Al-Bayda, and Derna peacefully. So this is the first lie exposed by NATO's contra, I would like to call them, NATO's contra, NATO's gangs. The second lie is the bombardment. The UN said that Gaddafi's forces bombarded Tripoli and completely flattened the neighborhoods of Souq al-Jum'ah, Tajoura, and Fashloum. And they actually named these neighborhoods. Thousands of journalists came to Libya after NATO's attack, and they visited these neighborhoods and filmed these neighborhoods. And they could see with their own eyes and the eyes of their cameras that there was no bombardment whatsoever to Tripoli's neighborhoods or the other cities of Libya. The third lie, which is the rape of 8,000. Of course, I always mention these numbers because I'm always shocked that these numbers were written down in official United Nations and official Security Council's resolutions. They did not have the high moral standards to abstain from writing down these lies. They said 8,000 women were raped by the Libyan army within the first 3 weeks, just before the issuing of the 1973 resolution, the first 3 weeks of conflict. When the Libyan transitional government, the puppet regime, wanted to compensate the 8,000 raped women, they could not find anyone. At the end, they had to make a scene. They had to bring in any women who would claim that they were raped to pay them compensation. And the number stopped at 35 raped women. This is hardly systematic rape by an army at a time of war. So this is the third lie exposed. The fourth lie, which everyone now admits it was a fabrication, is that Gaddafi's forces employed 30,000 mercenaries, black mercenaries from Africa. Of course, not a single soldier from Africa or a mercenary was captured during 8 months of war in Libya. Not a single photographic picture, not a single letter, not a single document was found to prove any payments to any soldiers from Africa or anywhere else. This lie, which was also documented in the UN resolution, was used by the NATO gangs to murder thousands of black Libyan soldiers and to exhibit them to cameras as mercenaries after, of course, they were, because, of course, a dead soldier cannot speak and reveal his Libyan identity. And racism is still very high in Libya, as many of you know. The poor people of Tawarga, which is a black Libyan city, are still exiled from their city, forbidden from returning to their homes almost 4 years after the war. They're living in tents, suffering and dying from diseases, under the watchful eye of the so-called international community. The last lie was the fifth lie, was the potential of a massacre in Benghazi, that the Libyan army was moving forward to commit a major massacre in Benghazi, and that the international community had to intervene to stop that. Well, first of all, many people do not remember this. NATO intervened on the 19th of March 2011. On the 17th of March, we stopped the march of the Libyan army towards Benghazi with the agreement of the West. We actually talked to France, we talked to Britain, we talked to the States. I was a member of these negotiations. And these countries said to us that we need to stop the marching of the army towards Benghazi, and that this will be solved peacefully, and that the West guarantees that the fundamentalist groups of Al-Qaeda will not control Libya. They will be kicked out of Libya with the help of the international community. Unfortunately, we made the mistake of believing the West. And the army did not enter Benghazi. Of course, after that, NATO still intervened and bombarded the same army. It agreed that it was outside Benghazi and not marching toward Benghazi. I remember we talked to the French, especially after the beginning of NATO's attacks. And I was present at the time. And we said just one thing to the French. How can you attack an army that you know, because of a consultation with you, is not marching anymore? An army that is resting in its own camps outside a city, waiting for the international community to intervene to solve this crisis peacefully. The French had nothing to say whatsoever to this objection. Anyway, you know, NATO intervened based on these lies. Everyone knows that these were lies. We asked in six separate official letters to the Security Council. I read these letters to the international community on cameras. I read these letters while being interviewed by the BBC and Sky News and by Fox News and CNN. In each letter, we asked the international community to send us a fact-finding mission to prove these lies, these five lies, to prove any of them, to prove that the rape, the mercenaries, the bombardment, the massacres, they refused. They said, we cannot send a fact-finding mission because of two reasons. The first reason is a money question. It's going to cost a lot of money, and we do not have money to send it now. So they have the money to send rockets on our heads and to kill thousands of people. And you know all that, you all know that war is extremely costly. They are prepared to pay for the war machine, but they are not prepared to pay for a fact-finding mission. The second reason, they said that they do not have enough time and experts to implement this fact-finding mission. The African Union, these are facts many people do not realize. The African Union, and especially South Africa, and there was an African Union committee specialized in the Libyan crisis, composed of five African countries. They proposed to the Security Council, and this was actually declared at the time. They said the African Union is prepared to send a fact-finding mission to Libya, and within 1 week, it will come back with the truth about the allegations against the Al-Jamahiriya, the Green Libya. A Security Council refused this proposal from the African Union. And as you know, five African presidents visited Libya during the time of the war, and they all had nothing to say but good things about the situation in Libya at the time. So all of these facts are ignored in the media, They are still ignored by imperialist politicians, and we all know why. We all know why Libya was attacked and why Gaddafi was targeted. For four decades, 40 years, Libya was a dignified, honorable country that was an integral part of the Arab world, of the Muslim world, of Africa. Libya supported movements, freedom-fighting movements around the world to free and liberate Arabic and African countries and even Latin American countries. Libya, at the outbreak of the unrest in 2011, was the president of the Arab Summit, was the chairman of the Arab-African Summit, was also the chairman of the African-European Summit, was a founding, the major founding member of the Sahel and Sahara Committee. Libya also was the main power pushing behind the African Union. Libya was the main member calling for the establishment of African currency and African common market. Libya was the main factor and power pushing behind Arab unity. All of these reasons made the West weary of Libya and wanting to destroy this country. They knew that Gaddafi will not slow down and will not stop his efforts to change Africa towards the better reality, to change the Arab world, and to have an independent continent of Africa, an independent and dignified region in the Arab world. They knew that his ideas and his principles are very dangerous. One of the main things that I myself heard firsthand at the time of the war, and I was shocked by, is a French mediator who came to Libya and said to me personally, why did you have to think and support the African currency, the African unified currency? The West sees such economic efforts initiated by Gaddafi in Africa as very, very, very dangerous and destabilizing for the European security, economic security, and for the dominance, imperialist dominance Europe has over Africa. Not many people think that such a project led by Libya to establish the common African market and the common, the United African currency, are actually the main reasons or among the main reasons of NATO's intervention in Libya. Libya now, of course, I dearly thank my friend Mr. Mabrouk Derbash on his analysis of the situation now in Libya. What I would like to concentrate on is the following. The first crisis in Libya now is the exiled and refugees. The Tunisian government declared officially through its Minister of Foreign Affairs that they have 1 million and a half Libyan refugees. I'm going to repeat this again. They said officially we have 1 million and a half, 1.5 million Libyan refugees in Tunisia. Now, we think this is a bit of an exaggeration. We think the number is less than that, but it's still very substantial. In Egypt, the Egyptian authorities also declared that they have 1.25 million Libyan refugees. We have huge numbers in Algeria and Niger and Chad. The total number, our sources affirm that it should be around 2 million Libyan refugees. Now remember, Libyan population is 6 million. Now 2 million is third of the country. Third of the country is outside, living in dire conditions, struggling economically, struggling psychologically. They have no rights. They cannot renew their passports. They cannot go back to their homes. They have no salaries. And they are even denied the status of being refugees by the UN. The second crisis, of course, in Libya is the dominance and control the fundamentalist groups have in the country. Have no doubt about this. Al-Qaeda and Al-Qaeda affiliates and the Libyan Islamist fighting group, they are the main military and security power in Libya. They have the weapons, they have the wealth, they have the money, they have the fighters, they have everything, and they control Tripoli. They control other major cities like Misrata, one of the biggest cities in the country. They control Sabratha, they control Derna, they control Benghazi or part of Benghazi. They control many, many other regions in the south as well. And many people don't know this, but the most fanatic and professional, if I may say that, terrorist leaders in the world are situated in Libya right now. People like Abdul Hakim Bilhaj, who is one of the shining superstars of terrorism. He heads the Security Council of Tripoli, and he has the biggest armament and the biggest fighting group in the whole of Libya. He is also an extremely rich guy. He has been paying European and American public relations companies to make him shine and look better. He's wearing suits now, and he shaved, trimmed his beard, and he is now meeting with presidents of countries. This guy is one of the biggest known terrorists. He fought in Afghanistan, he fought in Iraq, he fought in Somalia, he fought in many other regions. In fact, he was imprisoned many times, including by the Americans and the French, and finally by the Libyans. And then, of course, we made the mistake of releasing him. Also, Abu Yahya al-Libi and Sliman Bungumu and Abdul Rauf Kara. These names, for some of you, they would sound strange, but for anyone who is interested in terrorism, not interested in terrorism, this is a study in terrorism, will find these are the superstars of terrorism. These are the people who have links to the terrorists in Afghanistan, in Asia, in Africa, in Europe, everywhere. I read a piece of news from a French newspaper today, translated into Arabic, that said that there are doubt or suspicions, there are suspicions in France that the weapons used in the latest terrorist attack in Paris were actually imported or smuggled from Libya. Also that possibly two of the attackers in Paris maybe visited Libya and took some terrorist courses in Libya. So these are the main two dangers, but also in Libya we have 30, we believe the number now stands at around between 35 and 45,000 political prisoners. Many of these people are imprisoned in illegal prisons that no one knows the locations of. The lucky ones are imprisoned in known prisons, and maybe some of them have been visited by international human rights organizations. These people are being tortured. They are being mistreated. They are deprived of their human rights. Sometimes whole families are imprisoned. Men are imprisoned. Women are also imprisoned. Many of them die every single week. Every single week. A dead prisoner is taken out of his prison cell and buried somewhere or given back to their family. We also, of course, have one of the most dangerous things in Libya, which is the idea of the Balkanization of Libya. Libya is a tribal society. We have a tribal history, and this has been now fueled by the war taking place nowadays. Now there are voices that call for the splitting of Libya into three states. And these voices are being supported by some fundamentalist groups. As you know, fundamentalist groups do not want unified national strong countries because they cannot work and operate and flourish in strong unified countries. They want chaos. They want smaller geographical regions with wealth so they can dominate them easily. So for those of you who do not appreciate this, you need to know that fundamentalist Islamists, I actually do not like to call them Islamists, they are just fundamentalist takfiri groups. They work to split Libya into three regions because then they can have these regions manipulated and they can operate within these weak geographical and political regions. I have many, many, many notes. I realize I spoke for too long, and I think I have learned from my days with the media in 2011 that it's better to leave some of the talk to come up in the questions, because I know you will have some harsh, hard-hitting questions for me and for my colleague as well. But please think of this as a dialogue between all of us, and not a traditional question and answer session. Finally, I just want to take a minute to mention this. I know I left out many important things, but I do not want to leave out this one thing, that we are not just lamenting Libya. We are not just crying over Libya. We actually do have the possibility of solving this major crisis. We have a roadmap for the solution in Libya, although I hate the term roadmap, because now it's a buzzword used to lengthen conflicts around the world, and I believe it's an imperialist invention. But as Franz Fanon said, this is what happens to us intellectuals. We get colonized mentally, and we find ourselves repeating these terms. Because they work as shortcuts to convey our messages. So we have this so-called roadmap for solution. It's based on national dialogue in Libya. It's based on a transitional period in which all Libyans are included in a transparent political process of democracy. Of course, the roadmap does not include the fundamentalist groups. It includes both the Green Libyans, the Al Jamahiriya supporters, and the good members of, if you can call them that, of the February movement. Those who are not involved with NATO, are not involved with the fundamentalist militias, and those who agree with the Green supporters of Al Jamahiriya that Libya should be one country, should be an inclusive country, that we should get our refugees back from abroad, that we should try to build it from scratch through love, through our mutual shared history, without foreign intervention. So, and we are indeed talking to our Libyan brothers inside Libya. I cannot claim that this is going smoothly, and the main reason is the Western intervention. And I will talk to that about that more maybe in the questions and answers session. But we are not lamenting, we are working hard. And I believe that Green Libya will prevail through a transparent political process that will allow the majority of Libyans to vote at the end and to embarrass the whole imperialist world. And we will show them that the majority, the vast, vast majority of Libyans really, really, really yearn for the days of Gaddafi and the days of a Green Libya. This does not mean, I'm very happy that I did not forget this. This does not mean that we did not make mistakes. Some of them are bad mistakes. Our political system before the war was not perfect. We had many shortcomings. We had many problems, economic problems and political problems. But they were really very manageable problems, and we could have solved them. Unfortunately, the West studied these problems, capitalized on them, and paid money and supplied arms to fuel the situation in Libya, because the West wanted indeed to destroy Libya. Thank you very much for listening, and I'm here with you, friends. Thank you very much.